Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God bless everybody. Amen. Thank you for tuning in tonight already. I'm going to thank you before you even get here. Praise the name of our God. I am excited and happy to be back on Apostolically Speaking. I have not been on in either 2 to 3 weeks, so I am very pleased to be back tonight. I have literally missed you guys, missed talking, missed discussing, missed the wonderful things that the Lord does, the shares with us, just making that connection, meeting people, talking to people, and what have you. So those of you that are on tonight, I want you to go ahead. I did push back a half of an hour today. Usually it's 8 o'clock, but due to my schedule and everything that's going on, I said I was gonna come on at 8:30. So I think I'm gonna try this 8:30 time for a little bit. So those of you that follow, those of you that log in and friends with me and partner and those of you that like and enjoy and take away something from Apostolically Speaking, I want you to come on, I want you to tune on, I want you to share this and let everybody know, those that are in your sphere of influence, that I am on Apostle Kelly Davis. I have an interesting topic tonight we're going to be talking about, so I'm going to take a couple minutes before we go into prayer. But I want to invite you, I want to welcome you, I want to thank you for your prayers. I want to thank you for your support. Thank you for sharing. Thank you for the people that I have met, some wonderful people on social media through Facebook that I talk to, that I've connected with, and that I'm growing in relations with. So I think that's wonderful. These are some of the positive things that social media should be used for. So tonight we're going to have this topic about occupying and warring until he comes. A very interesting thing, and some things that the Lord has been, I've been walking through, walking in, coming through, learning. We're going to get into that tonight. Of course, Facebook knows I do not own the rights to this music, so a lot of times you have those that type it in. I'm not going to type it in tonight. I do not own the rights to the background music that you hear. It's wonderful prophetic music. Praise the Lord, and I thank God for this atmosphere that he have created. So I'm going to give you a couple more minutes before we pray. I have missed you guys. I missed being on. But I tell you, it's a lot that's cooking up. It's a lot that's transpiring. It's a lot that's going on. Got some events coming up. Got some prayer meetings, some awesome prayer kingdom things, the shaking that's taking place. I got some conferences that's coming up in April. Got another one coming up in June, a couple in April. Doing some prayer. We got the maps. We'll talk a little bit about that later, but just getting all that together. I'm doing some writing. I'm actually getting ready, like 2 steps away from releasing a book that I've been writing for almost 2 years now. I'm not going to give the title. I'm not going to put anything out there yet. And I have many, many that will follow. A lot of times it's about just getting that breakthrough through that first doorway. So this is the season. This is the year. This is the time that the Lord even spoke the beginning, saying that we're going to have experience of generosity of the Lord and the bountiful blessing of God. Amen. So I am excited. Hallelujah. A little physically tired because of the busyness, but in my spirit, the flesh is weak, but the spirit is willing. Amen. So God bless you, those of you that are tuning in. God bless you, Regina. Amen. I will be calling. I don't know if you're out of town or not, but I'm going to be talking to you very, very soon. I miss you. I know we played tag there for a little bit. I hope you and the family are doing well. I know that you are. So we will definitely connect real soon. You've been in my thoughts and in my prayers. But God bless everybody that are coming on. I know I have not been on for the last couple of weeks. My apologies. 2 or 3 weeks. I'm not sure. I know at least 2, might even be 3. But again, it's been very, very busy. A lot going on. I have not thought about being on. But, you know, it gave me a time to regroup, reflect, and get some new things going and release and share some things that I know, not that I think, that I know that God has said and that God is doing. God bless you, daughter Kelly, Prophetess Williams. Thank you so much. Those of you that can share this, please do so, because I'm going to just try to be on for no more than an hour tonight. I am going to discuss this topic. I'm going to share this topic again. It is dealing with occupying until he comes, and it deals with the kingdom mandate that was issued to us, that was given to us from heaven, from our Creator. Amen. So let us just open up and have a word of prayer. Eternal Father, we just thank you so much for this time that have been carved out, that have been allotted to us, that have been given to us in the earth. We pray now that your kingdom would come, your kingdom would come, and your kingdom would rule, that your kingdom, hallelujah, would take over, that your kingdom, we know that it's at hand, but we ask that it would be advanced even now through our lives, through this discussion, even, Father God, through this dialogue and through these divine connections, that your kingdom will be advanced tonight, that something will be said, the revelation will go forth, wisdom, knowledge, understanding, the fear of the Lord, the power and the might of the Holy Spirit, the great teacher, the great I am, the teacher of all teachers, the prophet of all prophets will show up, and that you'll begin to move and touch the hearts and the minds and the lives of your people. We decree and declare an open heaven. We bind all satanic and demonic and dark works. We restrict them from moving in the name of Jesus. Now we release the spirit of floods of revelation, of understanding, of power, of glory, and strength in my, I ask that you would open the eyes of my eyes and the eyes of your people, open up our ears, circumcise our hearts, that we will feel and know and discern your nearness and your proximity to us, Father, in the name of Jesus. We give you praise, we give you glory for what you're unearthing, what you're uncovering, and how you're taking us deeper, in Jesus' mighty name, amen. Hallelujah. Andalabasia. I just thank God. I heard so many things even as I began to pray, that there's a shifting, there's a shaking, there's an unearthing that's taking place. There's some things that's been covered up. There's some things that's been buried. There is some things that have not been able to live and have the light of life shine upon it. Therefore, in your life, there's been some stagnation, and we all walk through seasons of places where stagnancy and seemingly unfruitfulness and barrenness will try to come our way. But I'm prophesying to you right now in the mighty name of Jesus. I feel my prophet's mantle. I feel that prophetic thrust. I feel that prophetic push, and I feel the Spirit of the Lord urging me and telling me to tell you that he is really about to unearth some things. There's some things that's been hidden. There's some things that's been silenced. There's some things that's been pushed back. There's some things that's been on the back burner. There's some things that you've neglected and that's been neglected in your life. But I hear the Lord saying that he's about to move. There's a fresh wind that's coming, that's about to hit your life, and it's really about to disrupt the way the patterns and the way things have been going in your life. I even hear the Lord saying that he's coming, and you're going to know his proximity. You're going to know his nearness. You're going to begin to feel him. He's going to give you an unction. He's going to give you a prompting. He's going to begin to lead you by his voice. And I just hear the Lord saying that. So I release that to you right now in the name of Jesus. It's time to arise. We're in the third month. Hallelujah. We're still in the first trimester of the year, but we are in the third month, which is March. And I thank the Lord for the spirit of marching and pushing through and coming through and walking through and out, up and out of anything that have held us in past seasons, even in the past year that we just came out of. We're still at the top of a brand new year, 2019. And I still continue to say to you and prophesy to you and release to you, this is the year of the bountiful blessing of the Lord. That is a prophetic word that God gave, that I heard, and I decree it over my life, over the things that are connected, over my family, over my husband, over my children, over my business, over my ministry, over my spiritual children's lives, over my mother. I decree and declare the bountiful blessing of the Lord over each and every one of my children and grandchildren in Jesus' mighty name, and that your finances and your financial situation will begin to grow and thrive, that you will come out of a place of just surviving, that you will come out of a survival mode, and that you will begin to enter into a mode where you will begin to thrive, where you will begin to soar the heights of the Lord in the name of Jesus. And so I want you to take that word. I want you to receive that word. I want you to believe that word. I want you to begin to speak that word over your life, speak it over your finances. Those of you that have been going through a drought, even in your finances, those of you that have been, the enemy has been attacking your money, has been attacking, hallelujah, your income, has been attacking your ability to even make money. I say to you that you are a blessing. God put you in the earth to be a blessing. The word of the Lord says he will cause you. That means he's going to do something to stir up and provoke and instigate something on the inside of you. He said he will cause you, hallelujah, and he will cause you to have the power to get wealth. He will give you the power to get wealth, and he will cause you to generate that wealth in the earth. I release that to you right now in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Thank God for you that are on tonight. Hallelujah. We're going to move forward. Hallelujah. But I was taught at an early age in the spirit, do not quench the Holy Spirit. And when there's some things that God wants to say, I don't know everybody that's on here. You might be on here right now. There might only be a 2 or 3 or 4 or 5 or 10 or 20 on here now. But I guarantee you there will be people that will see this later. They will see this in the replay. And I've seen it already. And I know there's going to be increase in the name of Jesus. I even speak that in Jesus' mighty name. There was a broadcast that I did sometime back. I want to say in early January, maybe late. Maybe early February, and it reached many, many, many people. It went over into the thousands, and I had a lot of responses, and I had people that messaged me and people that asked me to pray for them and people who asked me for different, you know, questions and things like that. So I know that I've been positioned by the Lord. I'm not trying to make a name for me. I've been put here on the earth and assigned to speak as a voice, an oracle, to build, to help, to develop, to cultivate, and do all the things that I do. So whatsoever I do it as unto the Lord. I don't do things, and anybody and everybody that knows me know that I do not do things for show. I don't do things for my, in other words, for to build for Kelly. Praise the Lord, is for God. He's number one in my life. And if he's not shining and being seen and being heard, then nothing that I'm doing is even to me worth doing it. Amen. So thank you so much. Tonight, I'm going to go ahead and get into this topic because I heard something this morning when I was preparing to go to work. I heard the Spirit of the Lord in my conversation. You know, you talk with the Lord, and sometimes we talk internal conversations. We're going back and forth, and we're listening, but sometimes there's audible conversations, and I was audibly talking to the Lord also, you know, and I heard something that was a question that was posed to me, and he said, who are you influencing? As I was reflecting on what I was going to even be talking about tonight, occupying until he comes in warring, he said, who are you influencing? Hallelujah. And I'm going to pose that. And it made me think. And I went on about the day, and that thought was upon me. And I began to think about areas of my life, and I began to think, who am I influencing? And I began to think, you know, am I even influencing, and who am I influencing, and why am I influencing? What is my influence? Amen. We know that influence basically equates to, it's a form of power. If you can influence people, you have power. Hallelujah. Power does not just come in dollar signs. Power, money is a manifestation of a form of power, but money in itself is not power, because money answereth all things, but money is not the answer. There's some things that money can't answer. Amen. Even with the best amount and the biggest amount of money, I know there's a lot of cures for a lot of diseases and conditions. And I'm not going to go too deep into that because I'm real tender about that subject, because I just really feel like it's a lot of things that we know and that we have, and that God has given us wisdom to cure, and such diseases as HIV and cancers and different forms of lupus and some of these arthritic conditions and just conditions that they say we don't have cures for. But I'm here to tell you that even with the best bought money of science and allowing them to research and spending millions and billions of dollars, but there's some places that money can't go. It's not the currency of money is ineffective in some areas. Amen. And so money is a form, but I'm here to tell you that influence is power. Sometimes you may not even have money, but you can have influence and you can get the job done. If you influence and you carry a level of influence, and carrying a level of influence really deals with, is relational, and it deals with how your identity, who you are as a person, connects to other people and what you possess. And influence will speak when you don't even open up your mouth. Amen. Speaking without speaking. Influence speaks without speaking. There's many times where your influence will come through your mouth. It will come through your mouth when you teach, when you preach, when you say, just when you pass orders out, when you conduct, just little things that you do each and every day. Influence will come through your mouth, but there's times when you don't say anything, just when you show up and everything that you embody, everything that you bring and who you are comes to that moment, and your influence, who you are, comes forth in the name of Jesus. Amen. And sometimes there's an accumulation and sometimes there's a building up, and God is taking us and allow us to go through processes so that we can become influential and so that we can have that type of power to influence people. Amen. So having said that, God bless you, all of you that are coming on right now. Amen. I want you to go ahead and share this. Having laid that foundation, God bless you. I feel the prophet's anointing tonight. Amen. So I might just break out at different key times or key moments when the Lord says so and release some things. Jesus, I just want you to be sensitive and I want you to hear. But I feel the spirit of prophecy. I feel even that dimension of the prophetic word of the Lord. I feel it bubbling up. I feel it around and about me. And so I'm going to be releasing some things to you in the name of Jesus. Amen. Now, here's where we're going to go into this. Luke chapter 19. You, at the beginning of this year, I did a series called Kingdom Generosity, and I dealt with a lot of aspects of a business and the things that hinder greed, and I dealt with covetousness, and I dealt with bribes, and I dealt with the spirit of mammon, and talked about those things, talked about the influence of this world, the spirit of this age, and dealt with how it comes in and it perpetuates an agenda and a deep desire on the inside of us to have what we see everybody else having, to do what they do, to wear what they wear and whatnot. And then before we know it, we've lost the influence and we've lost the image of the one, the creator, who was created in his image and after his likeness. One of the things, I want you to hear me good, and you can tweet this, you can Facebook this, you can put this on a t-shirt. Amen. One of the things, you might lose people and friends, but one of the things you do not want to lose is his image and his influence. These are two very, very important things. You don't want to lose his influence and you don't want to lose his image. Amen. Whose image am I talking about? I'm talking about the image of the eternal God, our Father, the one who creator of all mankind. He created you and I in his image after his likeness. According to Genesis chapter 1, we were formed and made of the stock of the God Almighty, Elohim, the same substance, that's an essence of him that's within, that he contains, is at work within you and I. That's powerful right there. And that's why we are dominating people and we're a dominating force. That's why we are called to subdue. And we've been called to dominate and we've been called to have dominion. And we have been released in the earth to represent God and not in some weak capacity. There's nothing weak about God. Amen. We are fearfully and wonderfully made in his image and after his likeness. What that means is that we carry his likeness. We carry his image. When people look at us, deal with us, come into contact with us in our life, they should experience God, the God of the heavens, through your life. So that takes us back to influence. And so therefore, what are you being influenced by is very important. And if you're not being influenced by God and his word, something is influencing you. Amen. The very thing that is influencing you is also shaping your mind, is also shaping your desire realm, is also shaping the way you think and the way you conduct and your conversations and the way you live. Thereby, it is actually giving you a new identity. And a lot of times what happens is we become reshaped and we become remade in another image, and it's not the image of the eternal God, our Father. And then we begin to look like something else. We begin to talk like something else. Therefore, we begin to live like something else. And I'm here to tell you, when you look in the mirror, you see your own reflection. And we are a reflection. When we're like a mirror in the earth. When people come upon us, we should be mirroring God. So when they come to me, they should see Jesus and the work of Jesus and the love of God and the compassion passion and a strength and a word and all his characters, all his attributes. And I know that's a work that, we don't get that overnight. Amen. Somebody say process. Amen. But the way we are processed and the way we include God in our lives is through a process of dying to our own will and our way and accepting him. When we begin to do that, we take on his identity. We take on his image. We begin to look like him. We begin to live like him. We gain power. We gain authority. And we gain influence. And therefore, when we gain that influence, there's places that God will send you. There's places where God will directly send you, and there's some places he will indirectly send you. There's some places where God will lead you, and there's some places where he would cause, and he'll, even on the backdrop of your life, he's maneuvering things around, orchestrating like a symphony, orchestrating and pulling strings and rearranging things in your life so you will show up at that right place and that divine appointment in the city that he needs you, in the relationships that he needs you, on the job, in the career, doing the very thing that you were created and placed in the earth to do. This is how you maximize the ability and the influence, because one of the things you know for sure, people will be attracted to God. Everybody is attracted to God. Even evil is attracted to God. Darkness is attracted to God. He is such a perfect light. He is so perfect in all of his ways that even in the worst atmosphere, even in a dark conduced situation and atmosphere, those things are attracted to God. So we look and we run the opposite way and we shrink back in fear and intimidation and religion and all of these ideas and even our own agenda, how we want to proceed. And here it is, God says, I brought you to the kingdom for such a time as this. I placed you here, Esther. I placed you here, Daniel. Moses, I placed you here. David, I brought you here. Paul, I brought you here. And you were brought there for such a time as this to do a work for the kingdom of God. Amen. Somebody say occupy. When you look at that word, it's found in our New Testament, and it's pragmatio. It's where we get the word pragmatic. And we get a lot of our English word that deals with the practicality of things. And I'm gonna give you a definition of it. I've given you this definition before because it's so intertwined in this season of what I'm talking about. I almost always find myself talking about doing business on the behalf of the kingdom of God. We have to be kingdom-minded citizens. We have to be conscious of who we're representing, who we're influencing, being mindful of where we stand, what relationships we're in, why we're in those relationships. And we can't even just get rid of relationships because we want to get rid of them. Hallelujah, somebody. Amen. Somebody could be on your last nerve. Somebody could be have used you. Somebody could be have just wore you out and you just don't even want to deal with them anymore. But when we get in the posture and we understand that whatsoever I do this unto the Lord, and I'm only in this relationship and I'm walking through this pathway because God has me here, it helps me not to abandon the assignment and not to abandon why God placed me here, because I want to keep the mandate and fulfill the assignment of why the Lord placed me in this relationship. So you can get weary, and we're in our humanity, we get tired of people, we get tired of things, we're ready to shut things off. Just like you could turn the TV off and turn it on, some relationships you want to turn off, some relationships you want to turn back on. Amen. But I'm here to say to you that whatever the Lord placed you, wherever he placed you, it has a divine purpose, it has a divine intent, and you have to find out why God has you in the place, in the city, on the job, in the marriage, having the children that you have, and on the city, in the street that you live in. Why did the Lord place you in the earth with these different abilities, with these different passions and desires? Amen. Occupy, it literally means to keep oneself busy with. It means to do business. Amen. To occupy means to do business. Praise God. It means to conduct business such as a banker or by trade, and to busy oneself with. We're supposed to be busying ourselves with the work of the Lord. We're supposed to be busying ourselves. Here's the funny thing, and it's almost comical. when we say yes, yes, I will, Lord. Yes, here I am, God. Yes, to the Lord. Jesus is Lord of my life. But then we take back the reins of our very lives, the gift of life that he gave us. Why? Because here's, let's be frank. Let's be honest. God doesn't need you to be God. He needs himself. And he has himself, but the only person that God needs is himself, and he's all encompassing. God doesn't need me and you to be God. What he needs us to do is to conduct his affairs in the earth. He needs us to carry out his intention in the earth. That's what he needs. And that's what, because that's what he's desired, and that is what he have connected himself to. And so whether we say yes to the Lord or we do business on his behalf or not, he will still be God. He will still be on the throne. We can't dethrone him. We can't vote him out of his seat. He's King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Now, why do I say that? I say that for this reason. It behooves us to get in order, to get in alignment, to begin to talk. Those of you that are not spirit-filled, that are not believers, if you haven't came into a perfect relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, I'm here to tell you, no, you're not perfect, but he is. The church is not perfect. The church is not a place for perfect people. The church is a place for people to come to, because none of us are perfect. Amen. None of us are good. None of us are have it all together. We all are a work in progress. So therefore, when we come to church, we don't come. See, that's that spirit of religion. And many people say, that's why I don't go to church. They all hypocrites. They all this way and all that way. So you let stigma and you let conjecture and you let issues that you, what people have said about you, it actually define a area of your life and prevent you from coming into a relationship deeper with God. And you might say, well, Apostle David, are you trying to say I can't have a relationship with Jesus outside of going to church? No, I'm not saying that, but here's what I will say without hesitation, and we'll give you the scriptures to back it up one day when I teach, but it won't be tonight on that subject. He's everything the Father is going to do, everything God is going to do, he's going to do it through Jesus. Jesus came to earth to establish many things. He came to die, to rise, and to reconcile us back. But one of the things he did, he came as a man. And that was important for him to come as a man, because God gave man dominion in the earth. And so he wasn't breaking laws. He wasn't breaking and coming illegally. He had to come through a certain process. But why do I say that? He established his church. And he said, the gates of hell will not prevail. And he gave Peter the mandate. And said, upon this rock, you will build my church. And he began to establish. He ascended and descended, and he gave gifts. He set some in the church, according to 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and Ephesians chapter 4, starting around verse 11. He gave some apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors, some teachers for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying. For there was a divine purpose in Jesus establishing his church. The scripture goes further on to tell us to the intent that he might manifest his wisdom and his glory to principalities and powers and to the heavenly realm to know who he is. Amen. And so everything God is going to do, and that's just about three scriptures, but there's many, many more that would prove to you that for you to really walk out your purpose in the earth, you need to be connected to the body of Christ. Doesn't mean you're going to be necessarily, everybody is not a preacher, but everybody who decides to name the name of the Lord is a spirit-filled believer and have the ability to speak and represent him and even have the spirit of prophecies, according to Revelation chapter 12. The Bible says the spirit of prophecy is the testimony of the Lord Jesus Christ. And therefore, if you're born again, you have a testimony. Everybody has one. If you're born again and you receive Jesus' Lordship, then that means you have the spirit of prophecy. So you even have an element, you have an ability to prophesy and to speak and have a level of insight and have a level of spiritual, supernatural insight that just people that are not born again do not have. Amen. And that is a truth. That is a gospel. But let me get back to occupying. So we were put here in this text of scripture. I'm not going to break it down tonight or even use it in terms of teaching from it, but because I've done it before. But again, all of this so much intertwined and so much connects. I want you, those of you that are on tonight, I want you to share this. I want you to welcome people on. I want you to bring them on. I want you to, God bless you. Kylo Tony, blessings to you too. God bless you. Please share. Those of you that are watching, thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. Amen. The Lord is so good. And it's so many things that he is saying to us. But I want to get back to this Occupy. Everybody that's tuned in and that's came on, God bless you. Thank you so much. The Lord is saying so many powerful things. And the occupying deals with a realm of doing business on his behalf. So it's getting back to retrieving the image of the Father that we have fallen. We know man fell from grace. We fell from a commune relationship with the Lord. Jesus, who was the last Adam, not the second Adam, because second would mean that there's a third. It's a put him in a numerical order, in a successional line. He's not in a successional line. He was the first begotten from the dead. Amen. And so Jesus is the preeminent. Etola masante. He's the preeminent one. All things consist by him. Amen. And so when Jesus came, Jesus broke forth. And Jesus came to give us back the image, to restore the image upon us that Adam had lost. Amen. Now, why is it important that we bear his image in the earth? Because that deals with our level of occupancy. Now, I'm a reference to Luke chapter 19 just for a moment with the scripture. I'm not going to teach it. I'm not going to line upon line because I've done it before. But in that scripture, the nobleman went away and he gave a pound to each three people. And one of them, conducted business, did wise with it, and had a return when he came back to take an interest and to see what had taken place. And there was something that was released in that because he understood what he was supposed to be doing with what he was given. And that's the problem where we, as well-intended, loving Jesus, apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers, God has given us so much, but we don't know what to do with it. And because we have not properly discerned, used proper discernment in the body of Christ, we are sitting with talent and pounds in our hands and doing nothing with them so that when he comes and say, hey, let me get an account, what have you done? We don't have anything to show. The one had 10. He had produced more. He put it to the usury, and it means he went to work. He transacted. He did business on the behalf of what he got. And the nobleman clapped his hands. I'm using paraphrasing here. He was happy, and he blessed him, and he gave him more. Listen to that prerequisite. And see, let me stop here for a second. We think that to hold on and don't lose it because we get overtaken by fear and we don't do nothing and we get stagnant and we get stuck and we're not producing anything. And we think when he comes and says, let me see what you've done with what I gave you, that he's going to be like, wow, you are so smart. I'm so glad you held on to that you didn't lose that. That is not going to be what God says. It is not. I'm here to tell you. And there's you might say, well, Apostle Davis, how can you say it? Because this was a parable that Jesus was given. And there's many parables likened unto it. God expects when he comes back. And when he comes back, I'm not just talking about crack the sky rapture comeback. I'm talking about when he's checking in upon you, looking at you, when you're conversating and walking about this journey of life, he's looking, checking, and seeing, what are you doing with what I gave you? What type of business? What type of exchange? How are you bearing my image in the earth? Who are you influencing? What level of influence are you speaking from? Who are you talking to? And what are you doing with what I gave you? The second one had a return. It was a little bit less than what the first one had, but he still had something. And look at what his response was to him. He gave him more. Now, I'm here to bust the bubble of all of you that are sitting here. I love you, but I'm going to tell you, if you're sitting there hoarding and holding what God gave you, thinking that you're doing something great because you're going to have it when he comes back and you're not going to lose it, you are operating outside of the mandate of the kingdom of God. Matter of fact, you're not operating in the kingdom, because the kingdom says occupy, do business, transact on my behalf until I come back, not your behalf. And so we're trying to build our own kingdoms and we're doing our own thing. And the Lord is not pleased. He's not pleased because we're holding the very thing that he said, go put it to the usury. He said, go build. Shebe antanda bakura maveskanti anto otoramanta. He said, go and infiltrate. Kola basita. He said, go and penetrate. He said, go and assimilate. He said, go and dominate. And so ultimately, when we sit and hold and hoard the very things, the talents, the gifts, the abilities, the knowledge, the skill, the know-how, even when we hold back on ourselves, there's some of you that are listening now. God told you to go back to school. God told you to learn that trade. God told you to perfect that craft. God told you to go sit up under somebody and learn. God told you to sacrifice and pull away for 3 months. God told you to save. God told you to start an account. God told you to start a prayer line, a ministry of prayer. Get up every morning at 5. God told you to do a minute, and you're holding it like this because you're like, I don't want to drop it. I don't want to lose it. I don't want anybody to take it from me. You're not operating in the kingdom of the Lord. You're not operating by the prescription that the Lord has given you. And this included me. I'm eating this myself too. This is why you hear me speaking it in this form of fashion. I heard the voice of the Lord say this morning, who are you influencing? And I'm asking you, who are you influencing? Who are you influencing? Who? Who looks at you and listens to you because of the life that you have led, and you bear the image of the Almighty God, and you walk and carry an anointing? Who listens to you? Who can you talk through talking, convince, and persuade out of one situation to another situation? Who? That's not manipulation. That's not turning. The Bible says God turns the hearts of people. But don't make no mistake about it. Through prayer and intercession and wisdom and knowledge, God will give you a word of knowledge and open up a doorway for you to penetrate a situation, penetrate a region, penetrate a circumstance, and the door comes open for you to walk in and you to share and be that reflection of God in that hopeless, what was hopeless situation. The Bible said that Elizabeth was barren. Her womb was shut up. And she did not even think that she could bear children. But my God tells me, and my Bible lets me know, that God opened up her womb. God opened up Hannah's womb, where Hannah did not think that she was going to produce a child, because her others around her was having children and her womb was shut up. God opened her womb for his glory and brought forth a Samuel. And I'm here to ask you tonight, who are you influencing? Hallelujah. Where are you sitting? My God. Are you not allowing the influence and the image of God to dominate your mind and your life in such a way that you now have become closed, that you have now become unproductive, that you have now become stagnant, that you are not shining, that you are not allowing the glow of the Lord to permeate and dominate? Hallelujah. Why are you in the earth? Why? I ask myself that all the time. And my prayer constantly is, I live for God. I am a wife. I love my husband dearly. I thank God for him. He is my partner in this life. And I honestly wouldn't even want to have another partner. He's my partner. I love Apostle DC Davis. That's my baby. I love my children. I love each and every one of them. And they have their wonderful children. I love my grandchildren. And I wouldn't have other, if I get more added. As a matter of fact, I think one is on the way. Praise God. Amen. But I love my grandchildren. I love my spiritual children. But I'm here to tell you, I don't live this life for them. I don't live this life for my husband or my children or my grandchildren. They enhance my life. They bring joy to my life. They enhance me. They motivate me. They inspire me. And I'm joyous, and I want to be with them and be a part and see them grow up and grow into and go into. But I live for Jesus Christ. Amen. If the light of God was to go off, I would return to nothing. Amen. He is the reason I get up in the morning. He is what keeps me moving. And I'm going to tell you something. I would not be here talking to you. I wouldn't be an apostle. I wouldn't be a prophet. I wouldn't be evangelist, pastor, teacher. I wouldn't be nobody's preacher. I wouldn't be preaching at a conference. I wouldn't be writing books. I wouldn't be writing teachings. I wouldn't be leading organizations. I wouldn't be overseeing churches. I would not be praying for people. I wouldn't be doing any of those things if it was not for the Lord in my life. Amen. I'm here to tell you that without a shadow of a doubt. So it's important to me, and I want to tell you, it should be to you. These are some of the things that I know is very important that we do not lose. I said this earlier. Somebody needs to go ahead and type this in. Do not lose the influence, then do not lose the influence or the image of God. Amen. If you have fallen from these things, if you are not influencing people, if you're not bearing the image of God, influence and image, if you're not, then there's listen, all hope is not gone. The Lord loves you. Remember, when he made you, you carry a spark of God. You have the essence of him down on the inside of you. It's just a quick moment for you to pray and for you to correct some areas and return and talk to the Father, your creator, the one who shaped you and molded you and made you and put you in the earth. For such a time as this, you're supposed to be a shaker and a maker, and you're supposed to be a catalyst in the earth. You're supposed to be you are what activates and provoke things in the earth realm. Amen. And so if you have fallen from these areas, I'm here to charge you back up tonight. I am here to jumpstart you in the spirit and even activate you in some areas, because I release the word of life to you. And I say to you that you will live and you will thrive and you will come out of that dry season. You will come out of that dry life. I rebuke the spirit of fear and intimidation that taking hold, that try to choke the voice of your voice in the earth. Hallelujah. But let your voice be dominated by the voice of the Lord. And when you allow your voice to be dominated by the voice of the Lord, God will cause his influence on your life. Somebody say occupy. Occupy. Amen. I'm getting stirred up because I'm talking to myself. I heard the Lord say that this morning. And those of you that are just now, God bless you, daughter Alicia. God bless you, daughter Marcia. Thank you so much. Those of you that are just coming in, I'm probably ain't going to be on here. Let me look at this time. Maybe 15 more minutes. You're going to have to go back and catch the broadcast. There's some prophetic words and some prophetic. Thank you, daughter Regina, for putting that up, influence and image. Amen. You don't want to lose those things. You don't want to lose the image, and you don't want to lose the influence of the Lord. Amen. God bless you, Minister Claudette. You do not want to do those things. Occupying, doing business, transacting on his behalf will assure you to cause a river to continue to flow in your life. Amen. There's a thing called demand and supply. And there's some things that God does not supply unless there's a demand. And I even hear the Lord saying that he's going to cause that to arise in your life. There's going to be a demand for some things that you will put in the earth to do. It's just like in stores. They'll say, you know, they don't stock certain things, or they don't keep a back stock of certain things because the demand has not risen up to a level yet. But when people start calling in and going on the website and ordering more and speaking an interest and calling and going up to the counter and saying, hey, do you have this? Hey, do you have that? That owner will see that there is an interest in this product, and they will begin to stock that product. There becomes a demand for that product. I hear the Lord saying this. I hear this prophetically. I told you I feel my prophet's mantle tonight. Hallelujah. That there is about to be a demand for you. There's about to be a demand in your life. And not only is God going to demand the thing that he's very required of you, the thing that he put in your hands, the things that he formed in you and wired inside of you. You have some gift sets. You have some skills that's been hardwired on the inside of you. And when you go to bed at night, they go to bed with you. When you wake up, they wake up. When you're going through, they're still there. When you're on the top of the mountain or in the valley, they're still there. There's some things that have been hardwired on the inside of you. Just like your eye color. That deals with your DNA. Only way you can change your eye color. You can't. As a matter of fact, let me back up. You can't change your eye color. You can cover it. You can cosmetically change it and modify it, but you can't change it from outside of taking that eyeball out. And even if you took that eyeball out, there's some things scientifically and medically that would only make, and I'm talking about a real change at the root. There's some things you can't, in other words, here's where I'm going. There's some things you cannot change about yourself, so stop trying. It is part of what you were put in the earth for. It is where you were put in the earth for. And it's finding that out is what's going to cause you to begin to occupy. Now, there's a term that means, as I said, doing business. But I'm going to put this with that. And you have to occupy and war. Amen. War deals with, there's a term called spiritual warfare. And warfare is the Greek word strategia. And it literally means an apostolic career of hardship. It means to go through. It deals with a hardship, because when you are at war, it's a fight. It's a contending. And I'm going to tell you something else. But be encouraged, because if you're at war, that means you have something. The enemy and darkness and your opponents don't fight what they already have. So the very reason they're bringing warfare to your gates, glory to God, is because you have been identified, because they have looked at your image and they have looked at your influence. Oh, I hear the Holy Ghost tonight. Glory to God. Because of your image and your influence. These are two things I'm going to have to really, I might even have to write on this. I'm going to come back to this. I'm going to teach on this because it's being infused, but I hear it prophetically. But part of this was in my notes, but a lot of major part of this I'm hearing by the heavens in prophetic word to you. The enemy is after your influence and the enemy is after your image. Because you look so much like God. When you get up in the morning, he runs in terror. He sees Jesus when he sees you. Don't you think he remembers what happened to him when Jesus openly made a show of him, stripped him of his emblems, stripped him of his regalia, made an open show of him publicly, spectacle of him, and triumphed over him and gave you and I victory. Hallelujah. You don't think the kingdom of darkness remembered that moment? Praise God. And when you have allowed yourself to be so filled with the image and the glory of God, this is why the devil and the kingdom of darkness and the demons and devils and the hordes of hell do not want you to look like Jesus. They don't want to see Jesus, because when they see Jesus, he remembered that that terror stricken day when he was put back in check. Glory to God. Hallelujah. So do not allow disturbances, turbulence, calamity, setbacks, hard places, all these things to stop you from standing up and doing business with what God put on the inside of you. Going back to this text of scripture, remember the very last one, that everybody had did something with what they were giving to do, and they had a return. When God looks at you like an investment, he invests things on the inside of you. There's gift, talent, abilities, know-how, knowledge, wisdom, love. There's different things that he's taught you and showed you and hardwired on the inside of you have an uncanny, unique ability to do some things that can't nobody else do. And yet you compare yourself to everybody else and you say, well, she does it better than me and he does it. And why do I even, you talk yourself out of it, quite frankly, because you don't even do it because you think. But can I tell you, there's some things that only you can do, Esther. Vashti couldn't do what Esther did. Hallelujah. Mordecai couldn't do what Esther did. King Xerxes couldn't do what Esther did. And there was hundreds and thousands of other women and maidens in the Persian kingdom at that time, the kingdom of the Medes and the Persians. They couldn't do what Esther did. Esther was uniquely handpicked by the hand of God and processed through. And yes, because she yielded and she used what was on the inside of her. She used what she was given. And when that moment came, consuramante, and your moment is going to come. When your moment comes, be ready. When that curtain goes back and the stage comes and the curtain lifts up and you're on that stage, be ready to take your moment. Be ready to operate. Be ready to occupy. Be ready to bear his image in the earth. Be prepared. Be in prayer. Be in worship. Be in integrity. Be in honor. Be in righteousness. Be in all of these things. So when that moment comes and that veil comes open, you can, when that scepter is extended to you and the king says, what would you have for me to do? You will be able to say the right thing out of your mouth because you will be in tune with your kingdom mandate. Glory to God. This is what the enemy is after. He does not want you to bear the image of the Lord. You were made and created wonderful, beautifully. Some of you might be dealing with low self-esteem, inferiority complexes, rejection, and all of these things related to relationships, the way you was born, even in your childhood, and you might have been through bad marriage, you might have of loss, you might be grieving, hallelujah, whereby you have lost something. Excuse me one second, let me get a drink here. Praise God. Glory to God. Loss can unlock and unleash fear upon you. And what that fear does, it comes to paralyze you and make you stop and don't advance or do anything with what you've been giving and placed within you. That's a lie. I come against that assignment, that lie, that diabolical plot. I curse it to the ground in Jesus' name. I charge you to get up, to get up, to get up. And you can't go to the store and buy the image of God. The image of God is on the inside of you. It's probably buried, beloved, and you have to unearth it. And I heard the Lord said at the beginning of this broadcast, those of you that came in late, you need to go back and listen to it, because there's some prophetic words and releasings that God was giving me. The spirit of the prophet is I still feel that anointing. Hallelujah. But get up. Don't stay there. You have been brought to the kingdom for such. You have been brought to America. You have been brought to whatever city, Detroit, Romulus, Southfield, glory to God, Farmington, Taylor, Sterling Heights, Pontiac, wherever city, downtown Detroit. You have been brought to Michigan. You have been brought to Ohio. You have been brought to California, to New York, to Chicago, wherever state, city, and region you live in. Start asking God about that. Start asking the Lord, why are you here? Start asking the Holy Spirit to in and do you and to show you why you are here and what you were born to do. Amen. One of the reasons Jesus was so successful, hallelujah, is because he looked at Pontius Pilate straight in the face and didn't that. And he said, I was born for this. Hallelujah. What do you know why you were born? Until you really find out why you were born, many days will go by and 24 hours is in the day, and they'll just pass you by and you won't haven't accomplished anything. And just like the nobleman, when he came to the one last one and he thought he was going to get kudos and get more like the other two got in Luke chapter 19, he got judgment. He got a harsh rebuke. He got a cutting away. He got dismissed. He got canceled because he did not discern properly the mandate of why God, the nobleman, in this term I'm talking to you, why God gave you what he gave you. It's not to hold and hoard and sit back in fear and intimidation and be afraid to go forth. Go forth, Esther. Go forth, David. Hallelujah. I was at my apostles' church this past Sunday. Praise the Lord. And I needed to be there. I got some good worship in, but I was so refreshed, reinvigorated and downloaded. But he said something that I know, but the way he said it, I know it, but he spoke it and it unlocked revelation. David did not see Goliath as a giant. As simple as that said, I come to Lama Vent, Polyeveske Teleamantu Kuriante Keshka. Even when he said it, as simple as that sound, I yelled it out and it hit my spirit, and it's hitting my spirit now. David didn't see Goliath as a giant. Everybody else did. David called him uncircumcised Philistine. He did not one time call Goliath a giant. Why are you calling that thing a giant in your life? Because when you name it big and you name it formidable and you name it impossible to defeat, you release the superior posture of God that he puts you in, and you deduce yourself to a lower because you see this thing as so big and so impossible, bigger than God, bigger than the God that's inside of you. David didn't see him as a giant. David saw him as something that stood in his way, as an uncircumcised, unregenerated, lower than Philistine who came to defy the armies of the living God. In other words, David seen him as no match. And I'm saying to you, ask God to change your perspective. And sometimes you can change it yourself by getting in the word and getting in prayer and getting in worship. Get into what does the word of the Lord say about you? That's how you're going to begin to occupy and war. See, that this a warfare posture. Sometimes maintaining and holding and contending, that is warring. Strategia, Greek word, warfare. It's not easy. You won't always get the patch. Matter of fact, You won't even always get people to say you did a wonderful job. You are doing a great job. You're doing a fantastic job. Ask me how many times I hear that a day or in a week. But do I look for that? Am I in that for this? So if I don't hear it, because if I went by that, there would be weeks would go by and I wouldn't be doing anything. I'd be just like this. This is the posture of hoarding and holding. This is the posture of release and gaining. Jesus said it's more blessed to give. Giving means releasing, because when you release, you make more room for more. And we need to allow the Lord to change our perspectives. Amen. We need to see the way God sees us. And the way God sees is the truth. Everything else will look to you like it's so big, it's so insurmountable, it's a giant, and therefore you will shrink back and you will lose the image of God. I'm going to leave you with this last scripture because the Lord took me another way. I actually had some notes I thought I was going to get into. Maybe we'll get back to them next week. Amen. I'm going to be going into an aspect of dealing with that same topic, but a different dimension of it. Because it's a subject matter that I want to, I don't want to say it now, so I'm trying not to say it. But I'm going to leave you with this scripture. I'm going to leave you with this scripture in Romans chapter 1. And then we're going to pray. Those of you that came on late, please share this discussion. Share it. Invite people. I feel the Holy Spirit tonight, and my heart is really touched because I feel so many things. I'm picking up so many things on this broadcast tonight, and I know when the Lord leads me to go a different way. So there's many of you out there that are fighting with obstacles and big things and you long-standing issues and long-standing things that have stood in your way. But I hear the Lord saying, Goliath is no match. Stop calling it a giant. David never saw Goliath as a giant. He saw him as a problem that stood in his way. He saw him as an uncircumcised. And so in other words, he seen him as an unauthorized, illegal person that didn't even have a right to be where he was. And so David knew his God. And he said, you got some nerve. David looked at everybody else was afraid. David looked at him like, who do you think you are? And you need to begin to say that to these situations and these things that have stood in your way. Who do you think you are? And you run forward in the power of his might and you watch that thing dissipate. This is going to help you as I get ready to close. I'm right on time. Amen. I didn't want to be no more than an hour and right on schedule here. So in Romans chapter 1, I heard this morning. And the Lord asked me, who are you influencing and who's influencing you? I'm going to go into next Tuesday, I'm going to break down this process that I had in my notes that I didn't get to. I kind of went out and called them out, but I'm going to teach next Tuesday at 8:30 into these. The battle is turned at the gate, okay? And it's won at the gate. I started with that because we're in warfare and we know the gates that influence us. These they're called the mind shapers, the culture shapers, and we're supposed to be governors of our culture. We're supposed to govern. Occupying has an aspect of governing, and leading and dominating, and administrating and facilitating, and calling those things, hearing from heaven, and calling it out into the earth. Amen. But when we lose his image, we can't do that. Praise God. Now look at this. This is the human nature, and this is what we deal with in our human nature. None of us are exempt from this. Me, you, your apostle, your prophet, your evangelist, pastor, teacher. Care how long you've been serving the Lord. You are human flesh. You are subject to the ability to be able to fall victim to your flesh and the trappings of the flesh. This is what keeps us when we stay in the grace of God by obeying the Lord, following his word, being in communion and relationship with him. Here's what they did in Romans chapter 1. I'm going to go drop down to verse 17. For therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all God ungodliness and righteousness of man who hold the truth in unrighteousness, because that which may be known of God is manifest in them, for God has shewed it unto them. It says this, for the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made. So God does this thing where he allows himself to be seen. So the creator deduces and come by. When I say deduce, he came down. The Bible says Jesus became flesh. So that was a major reduction. Reduction is an understatement. Amen. Being understood by the things which are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. Because that when they knew God, they glorified him not as God. Here's the key verse in verse 21. Neither were thankful. So when they knew God, they didn't even give him glory. They allowed this spirit that's coming up next. Neither were thankful, but became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish hearts were darkened. So instead of glory is light filled. And instead of letting the light, allowing the light of the glorious gospel to fill them, when they knew God, they didn't give him glory and they didn't profess him to be God. And there was a turning away. And instead of professing God, they professed themselves to be wise. It says they became fools and they changed, verse 23, the glory of the uncorruptible God into an image made like unto a corruptible man. Romans chapter 1. When we knew God, we didn't retain him as God. We didn't glorify him as God. This is what the flesh does. I don't care how cute or nice or packaged or cut up or healthy your flesh is. It's still flesh at the end of the day. And it goes opposite to God. We have to train and bring ourselves under subjection by living disciplined lives. But this Bible tells me this is the human. This is dealing with our human condition. They choose not to honor God, and their foolish hearts were darkened, and instead of professing God, they began to profess themselves. So we lost the image. It got buried and pushed down. But Jesus came to cause us to recover the image of our Father. What are you doing? Who are you influencing? What are you allowing to influence you, beloved? It's time to rise up. It's time to get back to the front, the head. It's time to take the reins of your life and begin to direct them toward the courses of life that God has put inside of you. It's time to govern. It's time to occupy. It's time to influence. It's time to bear his image in the earth. Hallelujah. Glory to his precious, wonderful, holy name. Amen. I'm going to close with that tonight. I will be back on here next Tuesday. Praise God. Those of you that are watching, I want you to share this. I want you to, share this, and I want you to connect with me. Let me know what's going on with you, how you feel. Is this blessing you? Did this bless you? Praise God. I think you need to honestly really go back and make sure that you catch the first beginning of this, because and all through here there's a strong, and I'm getting ready to pray for you right now as I get ready to close, there's a strong prophetic flow. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Thank you for allowing your voice and your image and your influence to return back to us, your people, God. Without you here in the earth, without us bearing your image, and without us having your influence, we're nothing. We're brought back to that lodabar, that low place. We're nothing without you, Father. We acknowledge that. We're nothing without you. We won't allow ourselves to profess a bunch of other things and don't profess you. We profess that you are God, that you are glorious, and we give all the glory back to you. We ask that you would forgive us and cleanse us and wash us, God. We ask that you would strip us and rid us of all idols in our heart. We ask that you would rid us of fear. We renounce and reject fear. You have not given us, Father, the spirit of fear, but a power, love, and a sound mind. I decree and I declare power, love, and a soundness of mind to you. I come against that double-minded spirit, that double-minded nature, that double-minded voice in Jesus' mighty name. I command you to rise and I command you to shine. I command you to come out of a dull place. Hallelujah. I command you to come out of a dry place. I command you to come out of an unproductive place. I command you to come out of a fearful place, and I command you to step into your purpose, step into your destiny, meet that mark. Hallelujah. Prepare so when that stage comes, and when that platform comes, and when everything that you were packaged and made and fashioned and formed, when that opportunity, that moment comes for you to speak and for you to influence and shine, that you will not fall behind. I pray for you that you will not, I pray that same prayer that the Apostle Paul prayed, that you will not fall behind in any spiritual gift. Koma ante koramanta vande kurete eshku talama deke kitandalama horamandala batea vande kesholabohoya ramandele besete ande amanto. In the name of Jesus, and you will shine. And you will meet those marks. You will meet those deadlines. Matter of fact, you're going to go past those deadlines. I even hear the Lord saying that now. I hear the Holy Spirit. There's some of you that have deadlines and timelines that you have to meet. And I hear the Lord saying that you're going to meet those and you're going to go past those. I prophesy at the beginning of this year. Matter of fact, it was at the end of 2018 coming into this year. And I hear that same word that this is going to be a record-breaking year. This is going to be a year where you're going to begin to shine and break records. And there's going to be new trends that you will set. And yes, that's because you're supposed to influence. We allow the world and the spirit of worldliness, everything of this anti-God, to set the trends. No, we are called to be trendsetters and trailblazers. We are called to set trends, beloved, and you will begin to set trends. People are going to look to you, and you will be that standard in the earth, and you will be that standard bearer. You're going to be that mark. You're going to be that high place, that mark that people will rise to. And it's not that because you're going to do it. He told Abraham, I'm going to make your name great. See, when God makes your name great and when God sets you up, no man can take you down. No man, they can try. They can come against you. They can build the gallows, just like they did in Esther's time. But Haman, the very gallows that Haman built for Esther, he hung on that gallows. And so will your adversaries, and so will your enemy. Let them build their hooks for your neck. Let them build their traps and snares, and they sitting back to think you're going to fall. Let them build their gallows. Because I hear the Lord say they are going to be hung on the very gallows that they meant and thought you were going to be hung on. I release that to you. I pray for you right now as you go, that you will go in peace, that you will go in joy, and that this will be a record-breaking year for you, that this will be a year where you're going to set new marks in the name of Jesus, that you're going to do things this year that you have never done, that there's some things that's been held up in your womb. And I command, even now, I see and call forth that womb to come open, and you will begin to give birth to the very thing that's been stuck and shut up in your womb. You're going to begin to come forth. You're going to begin to release that. You're going to begin to bear those children in the name Antele Masondo Ramaki Kantare Medcenta. And I release, even pray, that resources and finances and blessings will not be a problem for you. The last thing I'll say as I get ready to close, that's one of the reasons why God is repositioning our money, because we can't do a lot of things because we have fell into this impoverished mentality and mindset. We have stopped doing business on his behalf, and we've been, I'm not saying we are, because I'm not going to speak that, but we've been broke, we've been lack, we've been slack. No more in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. It's time to have the abundance and the surplus in the stocks of the Lord. And we're going to have, and they're going to come to us. We will be the lenders and not the borrowers. Amen. So as I get ready to close tonight, I just want to share with you, this coming Saturday, we will be having our MAPS, MAPPS. We do Michigan Advancing Prayer Portals and Strategies. We go around the state of Michigan, myself and Apostle Kimberly Starks, and we have a strong apostolic team. My husband, Apostle DC Davis, Pastor Maria Carrera. We have Prophetess Selena Stevenson, Prophetess Ann Ware, and Prophet Delore. These are ones that make up our apostolic team. But everybody's invited. We will be in the city of Detroit this coming Saturday. We start at 10 in the morning and we go to 1. Now, The thing is, we're planning to be in Detroit, but if we're going to either be in Detroit or be in Romulus, I'm going to be posting in the next day or two for sure which location we will be in. We're either going to be in the city of Detroit or we're going to be at Kingdom Now, which is my home church, the church that me and my husband oversee in the city of Romulus at 11242 Grove Street. Everybody is welcome. We pray over. It's not a church meeting. I'm here to tell you, it's 3 hours of intense prayer and worship. We come, we target things in prayer. Last month, we were up in Grand Rapids. We had an amazing, powerful breakthrough. And we were praying for education and politics and government and all these things. There were so many things that broke forth. Amen. So we will be in MAPS this coming Saturday, March the 9th. We will either be in Detroit or in Romulus. Look at my Facebook page and I will have the site, the exact location posted. We do that a couple times a month. And we're going to begin to post where we'll be in April. But everybody is welcome. If you live in the state of Michigan, we adjure you to come. And there's some conferences that I got coming up. I will be posting those dates for you. But if you go to my Facebook page, Apostle Kelly Davis, you will see the events. We have Thrust Apostolic Network that we do. It's a training and equipping network that my husband and myself do, where we train fivefold ministry gifts. We oversee that. And that is actually every second and third Sunday evening at 5 o'clock at 11242 Grover Street. All are welcome to attend that, but don't come with a church mentality or church expectation. It's a network. And then if you want to know more about it, you can also go to kingdomnowami.org on our website. That's the website for the church. And you can look at the Facebook page. We have a Thrust Apostolic Network page, T-R-U-S-T-A-M-I, Thrust Apostolic Network. It's the acronym is TAN. You'll see the wonderful things. We're training, equipping, and readying the saints. Amen. And then every Sunday, we're at Kingdom Now, 11242 Grover Street. 12 o'clock noon, worship is amazing. A time that we have in the Lord, prophetic word goes forth, prophecy goes forth, prayer goes forth, miracles go forth. We move in all of that, amen. So God bless you. Thank you so much for sitting with me tonight and joining me tonight. I want you to share this. I want you to meet me back here next Tuesday at 8:30 for Apostolically Speaking. God bless you and have a wonderful night.